Welcome back, and we're going to jump right in to keep things on track for this afternoon. And so our first speaker back from lunch is Xiaomu Zhu, and she's going to be talking to us about narrowing the gap of the digital divide, how NSTL contributes. Welcome.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Xiaomu Xu from National Science Library, Chinese Academy of Sciences. Today, I'm very honored here to share with you something that National Science and Technology Libraries do for narrowing the digital divide in mainland China. For short, we name it NSTL, so I will call it NSTL during my presentation. The outline of my presentation today consists of four parts. Firstly, I will give you an introduction about the causes of the digital divide in mainland China for the last several years. Then, next two parts, I will present how NSTL contribute to the gap. And finally, a short summary and some future expectations of NSTL will be given. Okay, let's start with I will talk about the causes of the digital divide in mainland China. As you know, the terrain of China rises from the east coast to the west interior, which make it difficult to set up network facilities in some complex terrain. And in the early 21st century, advanced technology was not applied yet widely, so it was not easy to set up network facilities in these complex terrain. Also, network servers and other relevant facilities were insufficient. So few users had access to the internet during that period. According to the earliest statistics on the National Bureau of Statistics of China, the number of internet users in China was less than 1.8% in 2000. Most people were only able to access to the internet to the local network. But nowadays, there are already over 55% individuals in China that have access to the internet. Similar to the terrestrial distribution of China, the degree of economic development in different regions of China also presents a graded distribution, but the direction is entirely opposite, which shows that eastern coastal cities are developing rapidly, while the western regions are lagging behind in comparison. Here I put two provinces, the Guangdong and Xizang provinces, were selected to be the representatives to compare these economic divide in GDP per capita. You can see that GDP per capita in these two provinces in 2000 and in 2018 is shown in the figure. The GDP per capita in the Guangdong province is about two times higher than that in the Xizang province, either in 2000 or in 2018. So as a result, with the increasing massive needs for foreign literature and its high price tag, it is not affordable for Chinese individuals to purchase these resources by themselves, even in 2018. Okay, this is the economic divide. Furthermore, socio-demographic differences are also vital causes to the gap. You know, even in the rapidly developing cities, individuals due to gender, age, education, background, experience have uneven access to the information. So the reason for digital divide in mainland China can be summarized into three points: geographic, economic, and socio-demographic. Under such circumstance, NSTL was established that tried to narrow these gaps. NSTL was formally established in Beijing in 2000, which is a non-profit institution that fully funded by the national government. It is a virtual information unit based on the network platform and composed of nine core members, all of which are the national authoritative libraries in different disciplines. Since its establishment, NSTL has collected scientific and technological literature and resources in the fields of science, engineering, agriculture, science, and standard in accordance with the principle of unified procurement, standardized processing, joint cataloging, and resource sharing. all of which serve the public scientific and technological development. So these are the 9 core members of NSTL. To narrow the digital divide in mainland China, NSTL has taken a serious measures. Firstly, to eliminate the geographic divide, NSTL service stations were established since 2003 in important provinces and in some potential cities, depending on a number of pre-existing local scientific research institutions and libraries, in order to provide convenient access to NSTL and share the resources. You know, this section not only managed to set up regional academic liaison across the country, but also was beneficial in dispersing the visit flow and balancing the network load levels. NSTL information and resources were mirrored to the local sites from the primary station, so that people were able to view all data smoothly from different local branches, and registered users were managed by the regional stations. During that period, service stations helped to decrease network stress and management complexity at the primary station. With the rapid popularity of internet in mainland China, network infrastructure has improved dramatically. A 1 million bits per second per second broadband optical fiber network has been built between the management center and each member institution. Resulted from these upgrading high-speed network, the roles of service stations were changed due to users are able to access to the NSTL primary web page directly. In addition, being responsible for user management, the local stations have participated in NSTL key tasks and activities, such as projects, research, and promotions. With the help of NSTL, they contribute to their regional science and technology development, working together and making better use of the power of provincial governments and local research institutions. At present, there are 40 service stations covering 29 provinces of China. Secondly, to eliminate the economic divide, NSTL, which is fully supported by the state fund, organizes 9 members to purchase foreign scientific and technological literature and information resources according to the deficiency of disciplines in order to save the money and encourage the public scientific research. The number of various of foreign print resources purchased is nearly 25,000 each year. You can see the proportion of different types of new print literature in 2018 is shown in the is illustrated in the figure. It shows that journal and conference literature, both of which are the serial resources, are the top 2 major resources purchased. Nowadays, NSTL has become an important base of national science and technology literature for the whole country. In addition to ensuring full support for Chinese material, the number of foreign print resources ranks first in China. According to the NSTL official statistics, the total number of the type of print literature that NSTL embraces is over 275,000. In addition, NSTL has purchased electronic resources since 2002 in the form of national licenses to make up for the domestic historical deficiencies. So far, NSTL has over 3,000 kinds of electronic journals, either current or past issues, all of which can be accessed freely by the public welfare and educational group users. For current journals, full text documents can be accessed from database via internet protocol address permission. Some articles are downloaded over 10,000 times annually. For the older journals, a retrospective platform was established and can be visited by the nonprofit organizations. So NSTL purchased both print and electronic resources. For print resources, all of these full text articles can be searched on the NSTL webpage and can be ordered for uncommercial use with a reasonable price. For poor areas, especially the remote western regions, fully considering their limited access to the information and lower income. The specific price policy is supported. For example, document delivery service is offered at half price, which is much helpful for the local researchers. In total, each year, there are over 400,000 orders that NSL supplied to the public, solving the contradiction between urgent need for a large amount of literature and its high price. Since NSL is a nonprofit institution, the price of document delivery service is stable for several years, so that more users can use NSL without any financial burdens. For electronic resources, in total, there are more than 900 scientific research institutions, including universities and colleges in mainland China, that have applied for access to the NSTEL electronic resources. And NSTEL is continuing to expand to qualified nonprofit organizations in Southwest, Northwest, and Northeast China, so that resources can be shared and to maximize the economy of scale. With the consideration of national strategy, authority, and comprehensiveness, NSTEL focuses on integrated planning and scientific management to minimize duplicate resource purchasing, aiming to build a collaborative resource platform and develop a sustainable process to narrow the digital divide that resulting from the unbalanced economic development. It also improves the level of support to the national long-term and medium-term science and technology development, such as supporting the development of subject priorities, key planning studies, and some basic frontier fields by adjusting and increasing purchase varieties. Okay, thirdly, to eliminate socio-demographic differences, NSTEL tries to provide the public with an easy-to-use online environment. An integrated retrieval system has been built and improved continuously. With this system, like print journals, books, proceedings, dissertations, and other kinds of physical resources of NSTEL can be searched freely on the website. All of these resources are processed with abstract and cataloged in a joint way. In addition, over 7,000 kinds of open access documents have also assembled into this page so that people can achieve one-stop information discovery. In 2018, NSTEL has received 154 million hits and 9.67 million searches. Meanwhile, improving individuals' information literacy and their ability to acquire information is also conducive to overcoming these differences. NSTEL organized about 120 events in 2018 for different types of users across countries, such as literature retrieval courses for college students, training of using software tools for research institutions, introduction to deep information service for enterprises. All of these events received positive responses. Furthermore, a specific team concentrating on providing scientific and technological information for the Xinjiang and Xizang provinces, both of them are the western regions, has been set up. This working group is tasked with realizing local needs and requirements and to provide full support to them. On the one hand, brief reports of selected topics on Western development are pushed periodically to over 20 local institutions, which help them to obtain information about current development situations and relevant policies. On the other hand, to create opportunities for local librarians to broaden their horizon, librarian exchange trainings are held twice a year. Through these sessions, they have the chance to learn good experiences and to learn skills that they can apply to their local development. To benefit more local users, this working group also organizes field visits and offline courses. For example, two members of NSTL, together with a Lanzhou service stations, have held some activities locally. For instance, training sessions on utilization of EndNote software or Web of Science were prepared for people who work in the scientific research institution. Activities of science popularization, such as modern agriculture science videos and donated books, were warmly welcomed by the local children and teenagers. Although NSTL has taken these measures to narrow the gap with the development of the society and increasing international cooperation, new needs for accessing information emerge as each original gap is filled. Sometimes users want to be able to access the information from other libraries or even foreign libraries. So NSTL strives to explore information access approaches to develop international cooperation. Here, I take NSLC as an example. As the core member of NSTL and the Information Center of Chinese Academy of Sciences, document delivery access has covered not only within the Chinese Academy of Sciences, such as some institutional libraries, but also some domestic public libraries, university libraries, and other specialized libraries. For foreign approaches of information acquisition, NSTL has established cooperative relationships with the Sabito British Library and the East Asian Library of Pittsburgh University. So there have already been over 100 orders for international literature delivery this year. So NSTL contributes to narrow the digital divide in mainland China in three main areas and tries to close the international gap, which strongly supports domestic science and technology development. NSTL has adopted diverse and pragmatic approaches to bridging the gaps and achieved some significant effects. For future expectations, NSTL will continue to improve access to the resources to the public, especially for the information backward areas. In fact, NSTL has already made plans for these certain areas, such as Guizhou and Shanxi, some Midwest cities in China. Other planned activities include finding solutions of long-tail users' needs, expansion of international access to information, and expanding varieties of service models for different group users. All of these are also beneficial in resource sharing and closing the digital divide. So that is all I want to share with you about NSTL. We think it is also a new start to terrific life. This is NSTL. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We have time for a couple questions. If anyone has any questions about, I was amazed by the volume of resources. The numbers are so high compared to what we deliver at my institution. And I thought we did a lot. Any questions? You can always ask at a break and make connections then. So, all right, well, let's keep on track this afternoon. Thank you so much. So our next speaker, if you could start coming forward, is Dr. Collins Chisita. He is a professor, he is at the University of South Africa in Zimbabwe, and he is going to be talking to us today about the conundrum of resource sharing in Zimbabwe, the case of academic libraries.
Good afternoon. We are so elated, so invigorated, so rejuvenated to have this opportunity to share with you, cross-fertilize each other's minds, mental faculties with experiences, best practices, and everything that we can take home to share. So presenting in an afternoon is very important because you have come from solving problems of, the disequilibriums of the stomach. You have come from restoring your energy, from dealing with, attending to your metabolism, needs with regards to food. So I hope you won't feel bored or sleepy as we go through this exercise, isn't it? Okay, thank you so much. I'm from Zimbabwe, but I'm based in South Africa, and we are looking at resource sharing. Resource sharing as an activity in Zimbabwe, it has been strengthened by the proliferation of digital technologies, and also the fact that most institutions have managed to adopt open access policies, and also there's been the development of a consortia that bring together different academic libraries so that they can realize what we can call economics of scale. So there I have highlighted socio-economic and technological factors as some of the reasons that have propelled libraries to come together. And the need to come together is very important, especially in Africa, considering that economies at times are not that vibrant enough to proffer support to research, scholarship, teaching and learning. And as a result, libraries are left maybe on their own. So the only way to overcome such challenges is through coming together and working together as a team. So we view resource sharing as a viable option in the fourth industrial revolution, which is the 4IR, where we are talking of the Internet of Things, big data, among other current or novel developments. So we're looking at issues to do with sharing data collections, infrastructure expertise, as well as also, if possible, go beyond into sharing space. So in line with the principles of reciprocity, responsibility, and sharing, we believe that resource sharing is the only option for the survival of academic libraries in Africa. We believe that through parabiotic relationships, we can build a symbiotic relationship which can help us to overcome the barriers that separate us, and also to overcome the challenges of the paywall. So I have here put this baobab tree. The baobab tree is very important. It's a common African tree. And we've got a common saying that one hand cannot embrace the baobab tree. So what we are looking at this particular juncture is that resource sharing is something that we need to overcome the challenges that are brought about by the digital technologies and also the fourth industrial revolution. So through cooperation and collaboration, we can then be able to overcome our challenges. We have got basically two library consortia, one dealing with academic libraries that deal with purely academic areas, and others also looking at what we can call pracademic, technical, and vocational institutions. By the way, they say PowerPoint corrupts. If power corrupts, absolutely, PowerPoint can corrupt you. So I'm not following the PowerPoint. I'm following my mind. See, right? So we're looking at the sharing of services, human capital, extending the accessibility of resources, what you call democratic access to information, and also reducing costs, promoting the optimum usage of resources in support of scholarship, and also to prevent duplication of effort, so that where we have one library doing its own thing, that is becomes a waste of resources and will not get us out of this conundrum that we are looking at. So our statement of the problem is that we have consortia, library consortia, but we don't have a consortia that looks at nationwide access. You see, because resource sharing, we view it in the spirit of humanism, or what you call Ubuntu, where we say, I exist because of others. So no institution can stand on its own. So we don't have a nationwide consortia that can help to facilitate cooperation and collaboration, and then enhance resource sharing. Therefore, as a result of this lack of a nationwide consortia, you find gaps between one consortia and the other. And this also raises problems of licensing for electronic content. And we propose a resource sharing model independent from the fetters of institutional silos. So we are proposing a resource sharing model that can bust silos. Those are our research questions. I will not go over them all for the sake of time, but basically, how can resource sharing among academic libraries be enhanced to enhance, we used a multi-method approach, qualitative and quantitative, and those are our two consortia, the Zimbabwe University Library Consortium and the College Research Libraries Consortium. The main themes, we used thematic analysis to organize our data according to those motifs or themes. The open access initiative has now become an issue on the agenda, as evidenced by the adoption of the open access policies by nearly 20 of the universities in Zimbabwe. And this is a response to the restrictive access to knowledge, and it has helped to bridge the gap and also democratize access. And the consortium should be praised for taking the lead in promoting open access and also encouraging the adoption of open access policies at both institutional and national level, so that we can develop an informed citizenry and informed people. The development of most of the things we are looking at here are as a result of cooperation and collaboration, especially with the network of availability of scientific publications in ASP and the Electronic Information for Libraries, which is the IFO project. This dates back to 2000, when the economy started going down and budgets were dwindling, and libraries were still operating in a mode of what we can call exclusivity. And the program for the enhancement of research, we call the PERI, ran from 2002 to 2013. And then it was also replaced by another one, which is the SRKS from 2013 to 2018. All of these collaborative initiatives helped to promote access to information and also build a base for resource sharing. When we look at the status of resource sharing amongst these institutions, we find that the resource sharing operates from resourcing sharing of content, also expertise through conferences and workshops, as well as infrastructure. And even though interlending IRL still has a role to play, the only challenge is that it has not been taken serious as a result of maybe physical and geographical boundaries. It has been the cornerstone of resource sharing, but the advent of digital technologies, we share resources through consortia. These were some of the responses that we're getting from the respondents. And we find that amongst Zurich, e-resources is the lead activity, with interlibrary loan playing second fiddle. But however, IRL is still there, but the only problem is that it's more of operates on an informal basis, where libraries can enter into an informal arrangement. Other potential areas that we identified for resource sharing were sharing of storage space, cataloging, which was yet to be exploited. And libraries also were working together to develop an ISO, ILL interoperable system that would make it possible to share resources across national boundaries. That's the responses from CARUC. For the sake of time, this is what we can call an IFRUNET e-resource package for one of the consortia, where they are getting resources from different publishers, like Cambridge Journals, EBSCO, JSTOR, Oxford University Press, SAGE, among others. The list is inexhaustive. The partnerships have paid off dividends by widening access to databases, the promotion of open access, and also the support for development of electronic theses and dissertations, with currently there are about 19 ETDs. And these also the need to provide students with VPN links so that they can also have access to e-resources beyond their institutions. These are some of the resources that are paying off dividends through partnerships. And the silos which exist as a result of lack of technological complexity, geographic and economic barriers, legal imperatives, restrictions in interlending materials, poor internet connectivity, bureaucracy, retrogressive policies, and also the need to adopt silo-busting strategies that prioritize the benefits of cooperation. Right, the model we propose is that where we've got a main account license and the various libraries having access to different publishers to support teaching research and scholarship among the academic institutions. We've got their shared cataloging, online referencing, shared circulation, inter-library loans, shared storage for the sustenance of libraries within the Southern African region in Zimbabwe. Now, the model places member libraries on the same level because some libraries are bigger, some are smaller, some have more funding, some have less funding, some focus on very specific subjects that are technical, others have got a broader wide spectrum that they cover. The idea was to create what we can call an egalitarian model for access to scholarship. An egalitarian model which would also serve as a silo busting mechanism, and also which would also serve as a mechanism to remove barriers and promote parabiotic cooperation to enhance resource sharing. The model builds on the strength of all members and to build capacity for self-sustenance and also to increase bargaining power in negotiating a license to scholarships. It serves as a bulwark against the paywall. Single subscription with cross-resource sharing also helps to arrive at what we can call economics of scale, and also maximizing and optimizing access and use. So we say the model is premised on resource sharing as the way to overcome the paywall. It might not be a gradual process. I mean, an automatic process. It's a gradual. Brick by brick, we can reach a point where we can say, yes, we are able to self-sustain our needs for scholarship, teaching, and learning. To conclude, the model also envisages collaboration with NRENs. NRENs are National Research and Education Networks. These national research and education networks provide academic libraries with an option so that academic libraries do not fall victim to what we can call commercial internet service providers, commercial ISPs. So the NRENs have proliferated in Africa, with nearly each African country having its own NREN, and then an overall NREN for the continent, which is known as the Ubuntu Alliance. So we believe that instead of relying on these commercial ISPs, the costs are high and unsustainable. We should see more collaboration with NRENs. If we collaborate with NRENs, then it can help institutions to provide, broaden, and democratize access to scholarship, and then enhance teaching, learning, and research. We also believe that it can promote parabiotic relations among members. Parabiosis is a theory that is borrowed from entomology, where when ants cooperate, they don't lose their identity, but they remain with their distinctive identity, even though they are part of a cooperating group that is doing one thing. It also, the model also eliminates the replication of effort in collection development, and we believe that through nomination of a resource-endowed library, because our libraries are divided into two. We have resource-endowed with all the expertise, the infrastructure, the money to pay for internet connectivity. Then we have the resource-starved ones. And collaboration for the survival and sustenance of libraries, scholarship, and inclusivity will be very useful. Thank you, sir. There is no way we can succeed in the eradication of poverty if the developing world is not part of the knowledge creation, its dissemination and utilization to promote innovation. Higher education is a critical factor in making this possible, and it must be part of any development strategy. So, ladies and gentlemen, On that note, on higher education and its importance, from Dr. Mampela Rampele, I bring my presentation to its eclipse.
Thank you so much for that presentation. I love that. Was it parabiotic?
Parabiosis.
I love that. I had not heard that before. I'm going to have to look that up and make a note of it. Questions about Zimbabwe and that silo busting and trying to foster the resource sharing in the country?
What kind of level of resource sharing do you currently have? Who are your main partners for ILL? Are you working with people in this room, British Library, American Libraries? Just who are your partners that you're working with right now outside of Zimbabwe?
You mean who are my partners, me as an individual? Yes, we work with the different institutions, the British Library, the American Library, and also we have partnerships between our consortia and other consortia, inter-consortial partnerships and inter-institutional partnerships at a national level, regional level, and also international level. So the whole thing about resource sharing, it stems from institution within locality, and it is goes on beyond. Otherwise, most of the things that we have, we could not have managed to do them without the partnership, let's say with IFEL, INASP, Oxford University, and other bigger universities. You see, they say if I've seen further than others, it is because I've stood on the shoulders of giants. So we are a small country, but we are working with others also to realize the benefits of this weird, wired world. Yes.
All right. Thank you so much, Collins. So our last speaker for session two is Veronica Babaryka-Amelchanka.
Yes.
Okay. Sorry, I apologize. She's from the IS Lopinchich Belarus Agricultural Library of the National Academy of Sciences in Belarus. So welcome.
Thank you. It's through so many letters in my surname and my organization full name, but you can say only Veronica, and Bilal, it's acronym of our library, Belarus Agricultural Library. Bilal, it's smaller. And dear participants of the 16th ILDS conference, and let me thank the organization committee, like it's a program committee, and national technical library in Prague, and all who have helped to organize this conference. I and my colleagues appreciate the opportunity to present our experience the existing mechanism in Bilal that allowed to replenish the collection with national and foreign publication free of charge, find information on agriculture science and the production of open access resources, satisfy users' requests as much as possible through interlibrary loan and through participation in the World Network of Agricultural Libraries. And let me start and tell some words about our library. IS Lupinovich Belarus Agricultural Library of the National Academy of Sciences of Belarus is a national scientific agricultural library with the national repository of agriculture and forestry literature that performs a function of the National Industrial Information Center in the field of agrarian sciences and directs its activities to the information support for research and development in the field of agriculture science in agro-industrial complex of the country, and to provide every resident of Belarus with open access to national and international information resources on agriculture and related industry. Belarus Agricultural A library provides users with more than 170,000 documents every year and seek to satisfy the request of users as much as possible using its own resources, free access information sources, as well as sharing resources with other national and foreign libraries and information centers. This slide presents ways of acquiring information resources in Belal, paid, free of charge, and through partnership. Belal has collected and continues to work at replenishing the most representative Belarusian collection of documents on agriculture and forestry, food industry, natural resources, and environment protection. The Belal collection contains about 500,000 of print documents, as well as subscription to international scientific electronic resources, such as full text, abstract, and scientometric databases. Free source of exquisition takes an important place in the collection development of Belal. Under free sources, we understand the sources that do not include a payment for document or for access to information, but may include related expenses, for example, postal services. And this including legal deposit, publication of the Department of Agrarian Sciences of the National Academy of Sciences of Belarus, international book exchange, publications of the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations. Free acquisition of national scientific resources as regulated by regulatory acts of the Republic of Belarus and Bureau of the Department of Agrarian Sciences of the National Academy of Sciences of Belarus. A system of mandatory free copies of documents is legally established and successfully functioning in Belarus. These mandatory free copies include copies of various type of documents produced in the Republic of Belarus, as well as outside its territory, but citizens of the Republic of Belarus. The free copies are subject to distribution to the relevant state bodies and organization according to established order. In accordance with the resolution of the Council of Ministers of the Republic of Belarus, Belal receives non-periodicals and periodicals in print, electronic publication, combined publication in agro-industrial sector, agriculture, food and processing industry, forestry, nature resources and ecology, with a circulation of 100 copies or more. In addition, in accordance with the decision of Bureau of the Department of Agrarian Science, the organization of the department donate 5 free copies of their printed publication to Belal. Continuous online monitoring with the information system of the state bibliographic information of the National Book Chamber of Belarus allows to most fully track the publication of Belarusian printed documents which satisfy to Belal profile of collection development and to control the timely acquiring of free mandatory and departmental copies of documents of the Belal collection. International books exchange has been provided to be economically profitable way of the collection development with foreign scientific publication compared to their purchase prices. Thus, financial charges include only mailing costs. This type of cooperation is realized in the form of bilateral agreements on voluntary equivalent exchange of publications. In accordance with the agreement, first, libraries provide each other with information about scientific publication in the field of agriculture and the related branches available in the exchange collection. The second, send each other the requested publication from the exchange collection. Postage is covered by the sending organization, and the third informs the received of publication. Within the framework of the International Book Exchange, Bilal cooperates actively with 76 organizations from 16 countries. The main partners are agricultural libraries, research libraries, university libraries, research institutions. In the process of the equivalent exchange, Bilal receives free foreign scientific documents free of charge, paying only shipping cost, and that is many times cheaper than buying. Moreover, the international exchange of documents makes an acquisition of small circulation foreign publications possible and also contributes to dissemination of Belarusian scientific knowledge through the transfer of national publication to libraries and information centers of many countries. Bilal has become a repository of documents of the FAO in Belarus and receives free FAO documents on food, agriculture and forestry, fisheries, agrarian economy, veterinary medicine, statistics since 206. And during this time, the library received about 2,000 FAO publications in various world languages. In addition to the Bilal collection, library staff and users use sources of open access information on agriculture and related topics. Full-text open access documents can be presented in databases, websites of publications, open repositories of university and research organizations, scientific social networks. On the Bilal website, some open access internet resources are grouped into sections for more user-friendly navigation. First of them are section databases. This site section presents an annotated list of available in Bilal databases, including open access resources, such as e-library room, an electronic library and scientific publications, which provides more than 6,500 full-text electronic versions on Russian, Ukrainian, Belarusian, and Kazakh scientific journals for public access. For example, AGRIS, the International System for Agriculture Science and Technology, providing access more than 10 million bibliographic records, as well as to more than 2 million links to full-text information resources. FAO document repository present access to more than 68,000 full-text books, journals, conference papers, technical reports published by FAO offices. And core historical literature of agriculture, a full-text collection of landmark agricultural texts published between the early 9th century and the middle to late 20th century in the USA and Western Europe, etc. Dissertations and theses. This site section provides reference information on some resources containing information on dissertations and theses, full text of dissertation on agriculture and related industries defended in Belarus, Russia, Ukraine, Western Europe, the USA, Latin America, and Japan, as well as link to these resources. Research and development projects. The section provides information on some significant domestic, foreign, and international internet resources on research and development in agriculture and related industries, provides relevant links to these resources. And rare publications, this site section provides links to electronic catalogs and full-text digital collections of rare and valuable agricultural publication of the 15th, the beginning of the 20th century of some libraries of Belarus, Russia, Poland, and the USA. If information requested by users is not available in Bilal and it's not available on the internet, the library staff does it in other libraries' information centers. Bilal is a national interlibrary loan and document delivery center in the field of agriculture, and on related topic. In the system of the national interlibrary loan, Bilal most often cooperates with the National Library of Belarus, leading state libraries, libraries of scientific and practical organization of the Department of Agrarian Sciences of the National Academy of Sciences of Belarus, and the institutions of agriculture education. The right to deliver documents on agriculture and related industries from international information centers to Bilal was obtained in 1995 due to join the World Network of Agricultural Libraries named AgriNet. Maybe somebody know this structure. During the entire period of participation in the AgriNet project, Bilal has established partnership with more than 40 libraries and information centers. Belarus scientists that obtain the necessary information resources from many countries in the world. The libraries included in AgriNet, in accordance with the statute of this organization, are obligated to provide a requested document published in their country or its copy, as well as any other bibliographic information to partner libraries as soon as possible, and as a rule, free of charge. AgriNet was founded on the basis of the International Association of Agricultural Information Specialists in Rome in November of 1971. AgriNet has its coordination center, which has been located at David Lublin FEO Memorial Library in Italy since its organization. Today, AgriNet has 68 members from 56 countries. Bilal has established the closest partnership in AgriNet with the Central Scientific Agricultural Library of Russia, and during participation in AgriNet, more than 40% of all documents from abroad were received from this library. It is also worth to mention such a partner like the National Agricultural Library of the USA, which has been cooperating fruitfully with Bilal for more than 20 years. For more than that period, for this period, Bilal has received over 5,000 documents for Belarusian science from this participant. Bilal also established a system for delivery of Belarusian publications to foreign institutions and increasing the interest for an authority of Belarusian research. Today, more than 1,000 documents every year are requested by users not only from neighboring countries, but also from elsewhere. And the number of requests keep growing every year. The Bilal collection is information resources, is high quality services are one of the main information access points to the national agro-industrial complex. As an example, let us consider the following case. Efficiency of executing a remote user's request for library or full text documents in last 5 years is on high level. More than 90% of reserved requests were executed. And in conclusion, reviewed in report mechanisms for free replenishment of Bilal collection and share use of documents have several advantages. Free mandatory and departmental copies of documents allows the most complete Bilal collection development with national scientific resources. International document exchange contribute to replacement of collection with foreign book publication, which are not always available well, even for a fee. FAO documents provide information on research for sustainable development from around the world. And open access resources, supplement of Bilal collection and library loan and resource sharing allow to receive information which absent in Bilal collection. And in the end of my report. We express our gratitude to the MOST project for their support and our participation in this conference. In Russian, MOST does mean bridge. And this project organized professional exchange and mobility actions between Belarus and European Union for promotion, mutual understanding, and exchange of best practice. And thank you for attention. And I should like take this opportunity to extend a warm welcome to everyone and to wish a highly successful activity to all participants of the 16th ILDS conference. Thank you, and sorry for my temper.
Thank you so much. And can you tell us that you're two co-authors of your paper as well?
Yes, I want to prepare my colleagues, это Наталья Шакура from my organization, Дрима Муравицкая.
Can you wave or? Yeah, oh, there they are. Thank you, yes.
Thank you. And Tim, if you have some questions, maybe it will be an informal take, but you have it.
Yeah. Are there any questions? And I've had a couple people say, oh, my English isn't very good. Well, they put me up here today to be the one who makes mistakes and doesn't pronounce things to make sure I break down any barrier that you might have to being self-conscious. So don't be afraid to participate today and throughout the conference, because that's what we're here to do.
Thank you.
But thank you, yes. So...